Felix, you have just returned to the home of Daniel Radley after experiencing a play. That play was called Sodom by Anthony Carmichael. You and Mr. Radley are accompanied by a man named Lee Baldwin. The three of you are drunk. You have taken a cab up to Daniel's mansion. It's, I'd say, about 10 o'clock at night. It's raining slightly. It is July 3rd.
Okay.
All right. Baldwin has swung open Radley's door, and you're carrying in Radley into a long hallway. To your left, there's a parlor room, and to your right is a drawing room. The drawing room has nothing in it other than a carpet, and the parlor has furniture. Radley
Oh,
points.
well. Let's drag him in there. There might be more booze.
Baldwin is laughing and chuckling, and he says that show was atrocious, and he kind of plops himself down on this old raggedy furniture. Radley, when you set him into an armchair, he points to a wooden crate, and he says the booze is in there.
Oh, good.
All right.
I'll have a look in there. Are there any glasses about in here?
Do you say that to him, or are you saying that to me?
I'm saying that to him, or to anyone who's any either of them, anyone who's listening.
Baldwin seems to kind of be grumbling to himself, but Radley, he nods and he says, "They're in there. They're in the thing. They're in the box." And he just keeps pointing over to a big selection of wooden moving boxes.
Oh, God. All right, well, I'll start looking for the glasses and the bottle of bourbon or gin or something.
Yeah,
Not really bothered what.
he's got every assortment imaginable. And while you don't know him very well, they're being very hospitable. Radley has even gotten up and he's drunkenly walking over to a cabinet radio, and he flips it on. And it's at first static, but then you can hear some light jazz playing. And he kind of nods, says, "There we go." And he walks over to the light and he flips it on.
Well, I'll pour us all a drink, and then I'm finding a chair,
Right.
and I'll just I don't know pull over I'll pull over a crate and stick it in between the three of us and leave the bottle on it.
So you sit down, and as you sit down, Radley is sitting back in his armchair, and Baldwin, he's kind of lifting himself up. And he says, "Can't believe I wasted fucking money on that Carmichael guy, saying he's the best, saying he's the biggest producer, saying he's the best writer. That show was fucking shit." And
Where
he's
did you find him?
New York. Everyone in New York thinks that they're a writer, but Carmichael, he's this guy, he's this guy. And Baldwin's kind of going off on a tangent, and Radley looks over to you. And he says, "Carmichael used to be this big hot shot writer down in New York. He's actually got some successful plays. Sodom, though," and you are reminded of the atrocious play that you just watched, where a man was wandering around Sodom and exhibiting all of the sins of Sodom and Gomorrah in a sort of grotesque play that most of the people found just plain awful, but the three of you found hysterically bad.
I have to say, I mean, it was memorably awful. I've seen some bad plays, but I mean that was just truly atrociously bad.
Lee kind of
That
looks.
was spectacularly awful.
Lee kind of looks at you with this kind of just like this angry face. He's got like his face is like tomato red, a mixture of the booze and the blood rushing to his head, but also of anger.
Don't get me wrong. I mean, I think properly marketed, it's so bad that people would come from miles around to see it.
Lee then says, "Now after the critics have their way." It's at this point that the wind kind of blows exceptionally heavy, and the lights kind of dim out and they dim back on. And Radley kind of sighs and says, "Damn old house." So at this point, Felix, it's up to you to drive conversation between the two of these men.
Have you just moved in, or has this place been in your family a long time?
I bought the place at an auction. The house came with the majority of the stuff we're sitting on. You know, I'm from New York stock, like Baldwin over here, and he points at Lee, and he says, "But you know, Arkham is a nice change of pace. Smaller city, you know, it's peaceful out here. Well, when it's not raining, or there's not a windstorm, or there's not a thunderstorm, which is always."
Well, yes, it's fine for upcountry. I can't say I dislike it. I still prefer city life, if I'm honest.
Well, the house was rather pricey, but I will say that, and he kind of looks around the Victorian room, and you can tell that architecturally this is a very beautiful house. It's worth whatever he paid for. And really says, you know, whoever owned the place originally clearly knew their stuff. He had good taste.
It's a beautiful house, I'll give you that.
Lee then kind of sits up on the couch and he looks at you, Felix, and says, "So you were at the Angelica and you were doing shows?"
Well, I'm booked in for the weekend, the July the 4th weekend.
Oh. Rayleigh says, "So what kind of magic do you do? Is it just card tricks, or?"
No, I do card tricks, I do cabinet magic, illusions, a bit of mentalism, a bit of escapology. You know, it changes from night to night, depending on what kind of audience I've got.
Lee then chuckles and says, "Do you do fortunes?"
Not really my thing, you know.
He kind of scoffs and says, "Fortune tellers. You spend your money and money and money, and they tell you nothing. They tell you that your dog is going to be outside the next day." And Radley kind of looks at Baldwin and then looks at you and says, "I think that our friends had a little bit too much to drink." And he kind of walks over to Lee and he picks him up. And he says, "Time to go. We're going to get you up." Daniel Radley, he then turns to you, Felix, and he says, "Well, you guys can't drive." So, and he kind of looks around the room. And he says, "You can stay in the guest rooms on the second floor. I'll have Danielle and Bree, my maids, they'll call a cab for you in the morning. They'll give you breakfast. They'll ship you out."
"Well, that's very kind of you. Thank you very much."
Daniel smiles and says, "Well, you know, took the cab out here, you know, thought we'd have a few drinks with this guy. He's done, and frankly, I'm exhausted too." And Lee at this point is grumbling about if he gets a chance, he'll kill Anthony Carmichael for spending his money and swindling him. And he's just like muttering under his breath, and he's so drunk that everything is like slurring together. Like it just sounds like one big word. And he says, "Come on," Daniel says, "come on, I'll show you to your room." And he leaves the parlor, and let me pull up the house. So he leaves the parlor, and you guys begin walking down the hallway. Down this hallway, you can see there's a dining room, there's a door that leads to another room. You can't tell, there's a door blocking it. But then the hallway kind of leads north and then juts to the left. You don't see any doors that are down there, though. You have no idea what could be down there. Daniel then says, "We're going to go right up here." And he points to a staircase to your right. There are stairs that lead up to the second floor. And he just begins carrying Lee up the steps. Do you want to do anything?
Yeah, I'll bring my drink and follow on. And my coat.
All right. So he leads you up to the second floor. When you enter, it's kind of an open concept second floor, so there's not really a hall. You can see that there's a couple of guest rooms. He points to a room and he says, "Servants' quarters. We gotta be, you know." And he kind of makes the shush motion.
Okay, I got you.
He leads Lee to a bedroom and he opens the door and he says, "You go in there and you just sleep it off, okay?" And Lee, "All right, sleep it off." Daniel closes the door. He turns to you and says, "You can sleep in the second room." And he points to a door that's directly across from the master bedroom.
Right you are, sport.
All right. He shakes your hand and he says, "I'm sorry to do this. You don't know me very well, and for all you know, I could be a murderer. You know, you're just in my house. I'm sorry that I brought you all out here."
"Hey, that's okay. Not to worry."
"All right. Well, sleep tight. Don't let the wind keep you up." And as he says that, the wind hits the house again, and the lights dim, and then they come back up. So okay, he's going to approach the master bedroom, and he kind of opens the door.
And is that sort of opposite my room?
Yeah.
Or is it? Right. Okay. Well, I'll bid him good night.
All right.
I'll see you in the morning, I guess. And then get into my room, turn the light on, and I think I'll just. Have a cigarette before bedtime, finish my drink.
Okay. So you go to sleep. We're going to say that you go to sleep. It's now It's now about 1 o'clock in the morning, 4th of July. You are shooken awake by screams that are coming from outside. Someone is blood-curdled, screaming at the top of their lungs. You can hear someone is literally fighting for their life outside.
Christ, I'll pull my quickly pull my shoes on and run out.
You run outside and you can see you run outside and you see that Daniel's door is already open and he's looking out into the hallway. Across the way to the servants' quarters, the door is open and you can see that there are two 25-year-old twin girls, the blonde hair, nightgowns. They're looking out. The screaming is coming from Lee's room. And you can hear that there's some kind of struggle happening within the room. There's sounds of wood breaking, of glass breaking. He's screaming.
I'll open the door.
You rush to the door and you grab the knob, but the door is locked. Daniel then approaches and he's like, "What's wrong?"
"It's locked. It's locked. The maid's got a key. Is there a?"
The maid said it's downstairs, and one that you can see is kind of the dominant one says, "Bree, go downstairs, grab it," and she nods and she runs down the way as the second maid, Danielle, rushes to approach the two of you. Radley kind of forces his way between you and the door, and he's banging on the door, and he says, "There's something in the way."
"Well, let's the two of us. Let's see if we can force it together."
All right. So I'm going to need you to. So I want you to do a strength check. Okay. I want you to roll twice. You're going to take the lowest one. Think of this as a bonus die.
That would then be a 20. The lowest. All right. One.
So you're banging on the door. And you can feel the hinges starting to crack and the lock begin to crack. And that's when you hear, "Help me!" And then silence. You
Good
hear
God.
You hear the lock crack. And the door slightly pushes forward, but it's lodged against something. Daniel says, "Push!" And he's pushing. Go ahead and give me another roll.
Two again.
Yep.
Yep, with an 08 being the lowest of those two.
So you literally rush forward and boom, whatever's out of the way. And you've now entered into a pitch black room, wood, glass everywhere. The rug is torn up. The mattress is literally just feathers and springs at your feet. What was blocking the door was what was the bed frame, a solid oak bed frame that has been just torn to bits. So you're looking at destroyed dressers. There's a mirror on the floor. There's broken lampshades everywhere. Those ceiling lights broken. The bed frame is literally snapped in two. You can see fingernail claws, claw marks, in the headboard, the solid oak headboard. But there's no leak.
Well, let's, we need some light in here. Where is he? He must be in here. He can't have.
Rayleigh then says, Danielle, go and grab me a candle or grab me a flashlight. He then walks behind you and says, the power's up. The wind must have shooken it loose. He looks around the room and he says, where the hell is Lee? And he kind of looks at you.
Are the windows intact?
Do you wish to approach?
I'm going to wait until the woman comes back with her flashlight.
Yeah. Danielle approaches. She rushes back up from the first floor.
We just heard him.
And she says, "Here's a flashlight," and she hands you a flashlight.
Okay, let's start. Have a look around the room, see if we can find him. I mean,
all right,
he must be in here.
So, the bedroom, how it's laid out, is it's a 12x10 room, and then there's two doors. One door, which is ajar, leads into a bathroom where there's this big vanity with a huge mirror, and there's a huge bathroom mirror, and a porcelain bathtub with the brass claws. The other door, you can just assume, leads to a closet, kind of a small walk-in. You can see that the bathroom, there's also been some kind of struggle in there. Maybe he, you know, ran into the bathroom for some reason. He could be in there, you don't know. Or maybe he's hiding in the closet.
Let's look in the closet first.
You open the door and all you see, you don't see anything. There's nothing in there.
Okay, well, I'm going to tentatively make my way across the room to the bathroom.
Okay. You open the door.
Sort of sweeping ahead of me with the light of the flashlight.
You open the door, and you can see that, like, the soap dish that was on the countertop is now on the floor. It's cracked. It's broken. The mirror that overlooks the counter is broken. The vanity is on its side, and there's no damage that you can see to the actual tub, the bathtub.
Hmm. Is the mirror in the bathroom and the mirror on the vanity are both broken?
The mirror on the vanity is not broken, but the mirror on the bathroom is.
Hmm. And there's no sign of him?
No sign of him.
He's not in the bathtub?
You have an intelligence above 70. Okay. You don't need to make a roll for this because your intelligence is over 70.
My intelligence is 70.
Well, 70 and over.
Okay.
You can kind of make the assumption that what broke the mirror was the soap dish. The soap dish hit it for whatever reason, and it shattered the glass before it hit the tile floor and shattered itself, the soap dish.
What about out in the room? Are the windows intact?
So you go up to the windows, and if you look at them, you can see that they've been painted shut. So there's no way to open
them. There's no loft hatch or anything in the ceiling?
Nope.
I'll turn back to Radley. He's not here. He's gone.
Radley says, what do you mean he's gone? He was just in here.
I know, I heard him. I heard him. I was standing next to you. I heard him. He was here. He cried out. We knocked the door down. And in those moments between him crying out and us knocking the door down, he's gone. I don't understand it. I mean, there's no. You've just bought this. Are there any? This isn't one of those old houses with secret doors and things in it, is it?
No. This is an older house. It doesn't have the crawl spaces for the speakeasies. No.
Then where the hell is he? I mean, look, the windows are painted shut.
And he approaches and he goes to the windows and he looks and he's trying to rattle the window open. And you can see that the window kind of jostles, but the old, it's like layers and layers of old paint over this window. And then he looks out towards the woods, and he says, "Where the hell did he go?" And he's now looking around the room. He's looking at the floor. He's looking at the ceiling. Mick, give me Felix, give me a spot hidden.
Yes.
Is that a hard?
No, it isn't.
Do you want to sacrifice luck points to make it a hard?
That would be quite a lot of luck points. Well, I'm going to do that. Yes, it would take 9 luck points to do that, but I'm going to do it.
Okay.
I think it's an investment.
Okay, so we're going to take it down to 51.
Yep.
All right. Felix, you're looking around the floor just like Radley. And that's when, on the ground, past the paintings and the wall mirror and the nightstands and the broken bits of the bed and feathers, you see a rock.
A rock?
Looks like a pebble, about an inch and a half big.
I'll get closer and shine the flashlight on it.
So you shine it on it, and it's this, it looks like this gray piece of gravel. And Radley, he's standing above you, and he's, what are you looking at?
There's a stone or something there. It looks a bit out of place.
And he crouches down beside you, and he's scared out of his mind. He doesn't know what's going on, so he's going to let you make the first move.
Well, I mean, I'm just thinking, when you read mystery novels and detective novels, it's always something that stands out, isn't it? That always it's always a clue. Like if Sherlock Holmes finds something, it's always something out of place in the room. And here we've got a room and everything's smashed up, but it's all furniture. It's all things that should be in the room, except this little stone.
And he looks and he says, it looks like, and he leans forward and it says, it looks round, and then it looks like there's a completely smooth edge. And he's right. It looks round-ish, like an oval, and then on the back end of the oval, it looks like it's been completely smooth. It looks finely cut.
I'm going to take my take a pen or a pencil out of my pocket and just turn it over with the pencil.
You turn it over
and look at the flat side.
You look at the flat side, and it does. It looks completely smooth. It's just it looks like just like a gray, smooth marble. But if you know it's not marble. And as you're looking at it, you can swear to God. You can swear to God that it looks like a fingertip.
What is this?
I'm going to need you to make a sanity roll, because how could it be a fingertip?
A piece of a statue, perhaps? I have passed.
All right. So you just think it's rather odd that this fingertip is just in the middle of a destroyed bedroom. And Ridley's like, what are you looking at? What is it? Do you know what it is?
It looks like it's like the fingertip from a statue or something. I mean, have you got any statues here? Is there any architectural art or whatever they call it?
He shakes his head and says no. And
no statues in the grounds or anything?
He says, no, the grounds out back is completely overgrown with weeds and stuff until it leads into the forest. So there's nothing there.
Is your telephone connected?
He says we'd have to wait for the power to come back on, but that shouldn't be more than maybe 20 minutes.
I think we might need to phone the authorities, the police.
Ridley then looks up at Danielle, and now Bree, because Bree has the key. She couldn't find him for whatever reason. And Ridley says, I need you to call the police, Danielle. Tell them, and he looks at Felix, and he says, tell them there's been a disappearance. And with that, Danielle shakes her head and runs downstairs. Here's what's going to happen now, Mick. You and Daniel are going to be arrested. You are the only suspects. You are the only people in the house that have any, that even knew who he was. Daniel was the one that brought him home. So the police are going to detain you. You will be introduced, as soon as we introduce everybody else, they will be coming to you.
What am I suspected of?
They're just gonna, they think that Daniel has something to do with the disappearance. And they're containing you both at the Arkham Police Station to get some kind of answer from either one of you. Because one of the two of you has to know something.
But we're each other's alibi. I mean, we were both out in the hole. The maid saw us out in the hole.
You never know.
Greetings, fellow investigators, and welcome to our video podcast, Into the Darkness, where my friends and I play the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. I'm your host, Tom Rayleigh. It has been often said that time heals all wounds, but that is not always the case. Sometimes the wounds slowly fester and spread, and the only solution is to sacrifice part of the self. Our scenario is entitled Mirror, Mirror. It was written by Dean Shamshak and is taken from the Unspeakable Oath magazine, issue number 13. Our game master is Thomas McKeon, and it's his intention for this to be a sequel to Crimson Letters, which we played a few months ago. Some of the player characters are from that scenario. This is episode 1. The players are ready. Let's begin our journey into the darkness. Tom?
Thanks, Tom. Massacre was all the front line said back in October of 1929. Arkham Papers told the story of a conspiracy of ritualistic murder by a small segment of Miskatonic students. They were brought to justice, however, when an apparent shootout began between the student-led cult and Arkham police. But that's not the truth. So said a young journalist's notes that were found and destroyed before word got out. No. The story of that night runs much deeper, and it was only the beginning. On October 9th, 1929, on the cusp of the economy's devastating crash, six investigators were called to Miskatonic University to perform a job. That job? To find a missing collection of papers that were written back in 1690. These papers were called the Arkham Witch Trial Papers, and within its pages, unbeknownst to anyone, was a gateway between our world and a dimension of chaos and dread, a bridge between our reality and the worlds beyond. Together, private investigator Clifton Hawk, school journalist Caleb Winchell, police officer Al McKernan, claims adjuster Gregory Norcross, dilettante turned occult expert Trent Sterling, and professor of anthropology Henry Thompson, began a week of long adventuring that resulted in disaster. The group discovered the missing book had been stolen by a recently killed professor of colonial histories, Charles Leader. With the help of a former art student, Cecil Hunter, the two created an almost perfect replica of a book, of the book, in hopes of selling it off to a man named Abner Wick. Mr. Wick's clientele remained a mystery, but what the group learned was that these people would do anything to obtain this book. While Wick lined up the buyer, Leader got greedy and hoped to sell the book himself, never knowing what he unleashed. Because by copying the book's contents, the seals created by the book's original author, the witch known as Keziah Mason, were broken, and a demon from beyond was released upon any who touched the book. Just as the group tracked down both the copy and the original before they could be lost, a devious cult of satanic worshippers stole away Keziah Mason's youngest descendant, Amelia Court. After fighting their way through mobsters, zombies, ghouls, and a demon, they finally found themselves at the cult's ritual site. Six investigators entered, three came out. Amelia was spared the terrors of death, carried out that snowy night by one man, Clifton Hawk. Naked, shivering, and terrified, Amelia whispered something to Hawk, something no one else heard. "Something's coming," she said. Today, the year is 1930, the day July 4th, Independence Day. Usually a time of celebration and of nationalism, but there were no parades in the streets, no joyous bands trumpeting the nation's anthems down Arkham's avenues. Instead, the roads were clear, while a warm summer mist rolled down Main Street, passing over the boarded-up shops and apartments. We enter a period when even the wealthy were desperate for what everyone needs most: money. But though the city starved and the streets were empty, fireworks boomed above the rooftops, fired off from Independence Square. And illuminated in the bursts of colored light, sat a man in what was an office, but was now a makeshift home. That man was Clifton Hawk, a private eye who'd come on hard times. Since the Crimson Letters case, Mr. Hawk nearly lost his business, and maybe even his mind. On July 4th, he sits in his office, which he now calls home, drinking his money away, always thinking of the young man, Caleb, and the others that were murdered by the hands of someone Hawk probably would have called a friend. Every day, Diane, his former secretary, checks on him, walking home from her job at the Ferguson textile mill. She is his only link now to the outside world, to the hideous reality he created for himself. He doesn't respond to her when she delivers the loaves of bread and jugs of milk, because he's stuck in his own little world. As brilliant fireworks light up the sky outside his office window, Hawk sits on his mattress, drinking scotch from a dusty bottle. He stares up at a night sky outside his window, his mind blank as he watches the colors. He doesn't say a word, until the door to his office opens behind him, and a familiar female voice says, "Mr. Hawk?"
"Yeah, what do you want? Who is it?"
Hawk, you turn and you see standing in your doorway Amelia Court.
"Amelia Court, what the hell are you doing here?"
She steps in. She's dressed in, a normal button-up shirt and skirt. She's carrying with her a brown paper bag. And she says, "Mr. Hawk, I think I need your help." Or not me, but a friend of mine.
"You know, sorry, I can't offer you any place to sit. I don't have any place to sit. What's in the bag?"
She says, "Money. I want to hire you."
"I'm not much of a detective anymore. Go ahead. What do you got?"
She sets the paper bag down onto the desk, and she says, "A friend of mine, his name is Daniel Radley. he's just been detained by police. They think that he has something to do with the disappearance of an acquaintance of his, Lee Baldwin. You see, he and Mr. Baldwin and another acquaintance of my friend Radley were at his mansion yesterday night, and Mr. Baldwin disappeared. Radley told me that he doesn't know what happened. He says that Lee was in his room and he was shouting and then he disappeared. And now he's been detained and the police aren't letting him speak to really anyone unless it's through telegram.
You know, I got to be honest with you, after all that we went through 9 months ago, you got some nerve coming in here and asking me to take on a case that has somebody disappearing under mysterious circumstances. Good God.
But that's just it. No one else will take the case. Everyone thinks that Radley has something to do with it, but he tells me that he has nothing to do with it, that one minute Lee was there and the next he was gone. And you have to understand. Shit.
All right, look. What do you got in the bag? How much is there?
She says, all that I have in person, it's $100, the equivalent of $2,000 to pay.
Why does this matter so much to you? I mean, he's a friend, you said, but who has
because
friends?
Because no one believes him, Mr. Hawk. No one believed me. No one believed Caleb.
Well, what do you know about this thing? Well, tell me in detail everything that you know about this.
I don't know anything other than what I've just told you. I told him that I'd come find you and maybe have you go find the others.
What do you mean the others? You mean the...
The others... The yeah. others that night.
What, I'm supposed to... No. I don't want anybody else involved in this. It's way too dangerous. If it's anything... No.
It won't be. And Mr. Radley says that he can pay you handsomely if you can just prove he has nothing to do with it.
Oh, fuck. All right.
But he says that he'll only talk with Trent.
Trent? You want me to look up Trent?
He says that he knows Trent. He says that he can trust Trent. He doesn't know
anything. Everybody knows fucking Trent. Shit. All right. Oh, my God. What's our timetable?
He doesn't really have one.
Well, he's obviously being incarcerated. So is he going to trial?
That he told me is that he's being detained. The police are just holding him right now, but they're not letting him go unless they find conclusive evidence that he wasn't involved, because there's no conclusive evidence that he wasn't involved. You know these police. You know how corrupt they are. They squashed the story about that Caleb wrote. They essentially swept everything under the rug with the Arkham Witch trial papers.
All right. Oh, my God. I wish you'd come 3 hours ago before I'd started this bottle. All right, look. What's the address of this place?
She then pulls out a little notepad. And you can see that on the back of the notepad on the cardboard, it says Miskatonic University. It seems like she's been going up in the world since you last checked in on her. She then writes something down, rips it off, walks to the mattress, and hands it to you.
Right.
On it, you see two addresses. One to the police station, and then one to Trent's house.
All right, I want to know where this guy lived, this friend of yours.
He lived originally in New York.
No. Where did the body disappear from?
From his mansion.
Where's his mansion?
It's north of Arkham somewhere. I don't know the address. You're going to have to get that.
You haven't been there.
I've never been there, no.
All right, look. I'm going to get a... Oh, my God. Oh, I got such a headache from this shit. I am going to call Trent. I don't even know if he's going to answer. He's probably in the south of fucking France or something. Maybe I can get a hold of Henry Thompson.
I'll get a hold of Henry Thompson. That's not your concern.
All right.
You get Trent. Go to his house. Call him. It doesn't matter.
Do you have your number here? I want your number too. I'm going to get a hold of Trent. We're going to need to go talk to this Mr. Radley, you called him.
Yeah, he's actually expecting you at the police station. Once you grab Trent, just go down there. The police will let you in.
All right, we'll talk to him first, and then we'll go from there. Amelia, this is going to be the death of me. I'm sure of it.
She says it won't, and she just kind of looks around the room, and all she does is sigh, because she's just taken one look at your life now, and she says, "Find Trent and head to the police station."
All right. We'll call you. We'll call you when we know something.
She nods. She says that she'll grab. She'll contact Henry in some manner or form.
All right. Thanks. It's kind of nice to see you. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm in this condition.
She nods, and you can see that there's a lot of disappointment kind of on her face, and then she walks away.
All right. So I get out my Rolodex.
All right.
The last number I had for Trent.
Yep. It was to his mansion, which is also the address that she wrote down for Trent.
Yeah, I know where Trent lives. All right. Here's my phone. I know it looks modern, but it's not in fact modern.
All right.
You know, we should get props. I should have a Rolodex and shit on my desk.
We should do right. Props. So we're going to now jump to Trent. Trent finds himself sitting in his father's study, or what once was his father's study. Since the passing of his father, Trent has been mindlessly wandering the home. And now he sits in the leather armchair with a glass of whiskey in his hand as the fireworks go out the window, staring up at the portrait of his father. And that's when the door to the study opens, and Trent, you see Robert Booth, the manservant, and he says, "Mr. Sterling, there's a telephone call for you." "Unfortunately, we cannot hear you, Mr. Sterling. You seem to be a little far away."
"Oh, we heard you earlier. Trent. Trent."
I think he can hear us.
Mr. Sterling,
if you go deaf.
"The number you have dialed."
"Trent, perhaps you should hang up the phone for a moment and come back." I actually like that idea. If I can go to the Goodwill and find an old phone, and that might come in handy for these games.
Yeah, I may, when I move, get props.
Next week at Disneyland is Dapper Day.
Wow!
So I'm going to Dapper Day to see if I can find some vintage clothing.
Mr. Sterling, can we hear you now?
Can you hear me?
We can.
Yay.
So
you can.
Yes.
We can.
We just don't know who you are.
Sorry, there's a bad connection there. Hello, who's this?
He passes the phone to you.
Trent. It's Clifton. Clifton Hawk.
Hawk, my God, man, how are you doing?
That's not important.
Okay.
I was approached today by Miss Amelia Court.
And seriously,
she has. Yeah, no, seriously, I can't believe she showed up. She mentioned somebody who you may be familiar with, Daniel Radley.
Yes.
Apparently, okay. He was in a situation with a friend of his, Mr. Lee Baldwin, and he claims that Mr. Baldwin simply vanished. He's now being held at the police station, and he would like both me and you to come there and speak with him. I'm reluctant to get involved in any more of this weird stuff, but Amelia is kind of persuasive. Would you be willing to meet me down at the police station?
I'll be honest with you, I have nothing else going on. I need a diversion. Certainly. Well, let's do that.
I hope this isn't another one of those tear your hair out screaming and crying on the ground like we've done before, but who knows?
We can hope.
All right. I'll meet you down there in about 20 minutes.
Certainly. Thank you.
Make it half an hour. I got to clean up.
Sounds good. Thank you.
All right. Crap. I'm going to have to go down to Madame Leong's and see if I can take a shower.
Yeah. And with that, we're going to jump now to Professor Thompson. Professor Thompson, you find yourself at the Wilson Lodge with your friend, Professor Philip Baxter, the Department Head of Archaeology and Ancient Religions at Brown University. You guys are toasting to the finalization of the Hobb House Collection. He and you have just verified it. And he says, to a job well done. And to you for dealing with your issues. And he smiles and takes a swig of his drink.
Yeah, I will toast him, but I place my drink on the table as he swallows his drink.
He takes a big gulp and he sighs and says, so I think that I may be slated with Harvard to head down to Egypt to find some sort of lost tomb.
A lost tomb.
He says,
Whose tomb?
Yes. Some pharaoh's priest, something like that. They found it in the Valley of the Kings and they don't really know what it is. I'm hoping that you would be on the team to help track it down.
So I'll sit back and I'll think about it. And I'll say, well, yeah, the states aren't holding any real appeal to me. Why not? I need a change of atmosphere.
He kind of chuckles and he says, I think that every single American feels the exact same way as you right now. And he takes another drink. He then says it could take years to track it down, which means that we could be in Cairo for close to 3 or 4 years. And as he's telling you this, down the bar, you see a man who's had, in the time that you've been sitting here, which is about 10 minutes, he's had 2 or 3 glasses of scotch. And he's, you know, he's muttering under his breath, and you can tell that he's fucking pissed. And he said something like, fucking critics, don't understand. Don't fucking understand. And he gets up from the bar, and he's kind of wobbling over to the bartender who's fixing Baxter another drink. And this man bumps into Baxter, and Baxter says, excuse me. And the man then screams to the two of you, do you know who I fucking am? Do you know who I am? And he slaps the cup out of Baxter's hand. He says, I'm fucking Anthony Carmichael. I'm a god in New York.
And well, unfortunately, sir, you're not in New York, are you?
So and he looks
to god. You may be a god in New York, but you're nothing here. So I would advise you to replace my friend's drink and sober on up and head on out.
And he turns to you, and he's a rather young man, probably 20, I'd say 27. He hasn't quite hit midlife. He's got this greasy black hair. He turns and looks at you and says, what are you going to do about it, old man? And he kind of gets in your face. And the bartender says, ease up. But the bartender's going to let you kind of work it out.
I think you have a hot head, my friend. And I pick up my drink, and I pour it on his greasy head. I said, I think that should cool you off a bit. Now get out of here.
Damn, man. Baxter, he's never been in this kind of situation before. And especially in a place like the Wilson Lounge, which is like a very fancy, what once was a very fancy speakeasy. Carmichael, he grits his teeth and he looks over to the bartender who's waving over a bouncer. And Carmichael, he looks at you and he jabs his finger in your chest and he says, I'm going to make you pay. And I'm going to make all you fuckers pay. And he just gets up and he walks out. The bouncer kind of leads him down the stairs to the street. And Baxter kind of chuckles and says, that went well.
Yeah, well, the young man needs to learn how to hold his drink. I guess I have a few bills left. I'll buy Baxter another drink, and I'll ask him if he's all right.
He smiles and he nods. And he says, "I've been through worse," and he kind of chuckles because he's dealing with what he knows and what you know rather well. Mm-hmm. But you hear the door open, you hear the bouncer kind of throw Carmichael out onto the street, the fireworks are going off. But then you hear the tapping of small feet against the wood boards. Then when you turn to look, you see it's this 10-year-old kid. And he's got the hat, and he's got he's kind of bundled up, and he's got a kind of tan sack with him, and he says, I've got a message for Henry Thompson.
All right, I'll turn to him, I'll give him a look, and I'll say, I'll give him more or less a pointed look, like, yeah, what do you want?
And he walks and he says, telegram for you, sir, and he hands it to you.
All right, I'll take a look at it.
The telegram says, Professor Thompson, a friend of mine recommended I contact you. I'm in dire need of your expertise and experience in the unexplainable. In short, I need your help. Please come to the Arkham Police Department immediately. I promise not to waste your time and to make it very worth your while. Please, no one believes me. Signed, Daniel Radley.
Does the name sound familiar to me?
Yeah, you can kind of, I mean, you're in a very tight social circle with Ivy League schools, and you know that Radley has connections and ties with Harvard and Columbia rather than Miskatonic or Brown. So, but you recognize the name.
Okay.
Baxter kind of looks at you and looks at the telegram and says, what does it say?
I'll hand it to him.
And he looks it over, and his kind of cheery face then turns very somber. And he hands it back to you, and he says, you should go.
All right, I'll arch my eyebrow. I'll say, why? Why should I go?
And he smiles, and he says, because no one would have believed you.
I see.
Maybe you should go and hear him out.
All right. I was thinking about doing that anyway, but we'll talk more about Egypt later.
He says, yes, and remind me that I have something to show you when we get back to Providence.
Okay.
All right. He smiles, and you head to the police station. Yep. Now we jump to our final two. Dexter and Tommy. Dexter and Tommy, you're sitting in a car. The mist is rolling out and rain is beginning. The fireworks have stopped because of the rain. Dexter's in the driver's seat. Tommy's in the passenger. What you're looking at ahead of you is the Miskatonic Quad. In the back seat, Dexter's informant is kind of sitting between the two of you. And he points out the windshield and he says, That's her. And he points to a woman that's walking across the quad to Eli Hall. He then he looks at Tommy and says, "You'll get your answers from her."
Okay.
Okay.
And he leans back in his seat. And he kind of looks at Dexter and he says, "Now give me the money."
"How much do I owe you?" And I...
He then says, $2.
I hand him $2 and then here you go.
He kind of snatches it from your grasp and he says, "Good working with you, Fowler. See you next time you need something." And he gets out of your car and he walks across the street.
Yeah, I say thank you so much before he leaves the car.
Okay. All right. So this woman is walking now into Eli Hall. What are the two of you going to do?
I'm going to keep... I'm going to keep an eye on her and just keep distance. And then if she goes in, I will kind of get up. I'll get closer.
Okay. In order to get closer, you'd have to leave the car. You'd have to walk across the car, or the quad. But the two of you watch, and she does walk up the steps, and she does enter into Eli Hall.
We know who this is, right? This is Amelia.
This is Amelia.
Yeah.
Okay. What do you want to do? You want to...
Yeah. It's a follower.
Okay. That sounds good. If we ask, we... Yeah, let's just follow her in there.
Okay.
Sorry, Thomas. But, okay. Never mind. Go ahead. Sorry.
Okay. All right. So you guys are walking across the quad. It's kind of drizzling. And you walk up the steps to Eli Hall. It's rather late, so no one should be in the building. Fowler, you click the latch and you open the door. It's open, and you walk into the hall.
And sounds good.
Okay, Fowler, because you're a private eye, you look to the left and you see a cork board with all of the attendings, and you can see Amelia Court, attending professor of colonial history.
Okay, I look at back of my back of all my information on her, and I'm like, and I kind of mutter myself, she must move up pretty quick.
Yeah, I know her, right? Or at least know of her.
You know of her. You know that she was the leader's assistant, and that a couple months ago she was just placed into a professor role.
Oh, she's an actual professor.
She's an actual professor. She doesn't have tenure yet, but she's an actual professor. She took over Roach's and leader's job.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that seems really weird that she would... that these guys would go, would, you know, disappear, and she becomes the, you know, takes their jobs. That seems kind of fishy to me.
Yeah, I agree. Unless she was much smarter than the secretary that we assume she was.
So, yeah. You see the room number. It's the same room number as Professor Leader's old office. So it's up on the second floor.
Okay, you wanna let's try to get closer to her.
Sorry, Thomas, I'm a little confused. We're actually just trying to find her and speak with her, or are we like
tailing her? You're gonna confront her.
Okay, that's what I thought.
Yeah. All right. So you guys walk upstairs. You turn the corner, and you see the door to her office is open.
Okay. Is there anyone, just from what it's, from what I see. Is there anyone in there?
All you can see is just the cracked door, so you can't really see past.
Okay, I will open up the door even more.
All right, so you walk up to the door and you open it, and what you see is Amelia Court standing in the very center of the office. To her right is a mirror, views to the wall, and just beneath her is the bloodstain where Leader died. And in her hand, in her shaking hand, she's holding up a small pistol, a small pebble shooter.
Okay.
And she kind of barks, "Who are you?" And she's like violently shaking. She's like terrified.
Well, sorry to bother you, ma'am. I am Mr. Fowler. I just came to ask you a few questions.
She looks past you and she sees Tommy and she says, "Who is that?" And she then points the gun at Tommy. And like I said, and now she's even more, she's terrified.
I say, whoa. Can you hold, take the gun down? We mean no harm.
She's looking at, she's like, her eyes are crossing between the two of you. She says, what are you here for?
We just came to ask you a few questions.
About what?
About a few months ago. That's what I basically say.
She looks at Tommy and says, "What about it from a few months ago?"
We heard, did you know Caleb?
And when you say Caleb's name, her face goes like completely white. And she like lowers the gun. I'm going to make a roll, which always means good things. And only
before
always
before you roll, I'm going to dive out of the doorway.
Okay. She got a two. She looks at Fowler and says, "You're that private investigator, the famous one."
Yes, I am.
She then looks at you, Tommy, and she says, "And you want to know about Caleb?"
Yes. Also, Al, and also Norcroft.
She just looks a little stunned and shaken, and she takes a couple steps back, and she sits down on the desk, and she says, "I can't," and she's just shaking her head, but then she stops, and she looks up at the two of you and says, "If you found me," and she then goes around the desk and pulls out her notebook and writes down something. And she looks up at you, Fowler, and Tommy. And she says, "How would you like to make money?"
My eyes kind of light up.
How much money?
She'll make it worth your while. And she rips off the paper and she says, "And you'll get the answers that you're looking for."
Okay. I say, yeah, that can.
Well, wait a minute. What do you want us to do?
She then says, "I need you to go to the police station." And she hands Fowler the piece of paper. And she says, "A friend of mine, Daniel Radley, he's being accused of being involved with the disappearance of an acquaintance of his. He and another person, they're at the prison, or not the prison, but the police station now. There are a few people that I've hired on," and she kind of strays off, and then she shakes her head and says, "They were there that night when it happened to Caleb and Al, and
Yeah. Okay. That sounds actually really good. I just want some answers.
Did we lose Thomas? Is he frozen? Thomas, are you there?
I think he's frozen.
Uh-oh. Amelia, wake up.
It sounded like he was in the middle of a sentence. And
yeah, I think so. Stopped.
So it's 6:38. That way I know where to cut out this part.
But, no, I...
Well, we'll wait for him to get back before we continue talking. Yeah. Otherwise, it won't make any sense. Maybe he's just stunned.
I don't know. I think that was a good way. I don't know.
Thomas. Here he comes. His tentacle is showing. Oh.
He'll probably walk back in.
Thomas McKeon, internet just went out. Give me a moment. This feels good. This feels creepy. We're back in business.
Yeah.
I ain't gonna look in any mirrors. No way.
I couldn't believe the blood stain still in the carpet.
Yeah, I'll have to.
A little OxyClean would take care of that.
Yeah.
Red wine.
Well, is it her office or?
That's
or a. She just happened to walk in there right now.
No, that's leader's. That's leader's off. That's actually leader's old office.
Well, I know that, but it has been leader's office for 9 months.
But that's her office, I think.
That's how I understood it.
I had a clean carpet.
That's her office that maybe she just moved in a few weeks ago. Who knows?
I still have tossed the carpet.
Yeah, but
we'll see.
Maybe she sleeps on it and finds for his return. Spill a little blood on it. It'll be like... was it Clive Barker? It'll come back.
Yep, Hellraiser.
Hellraiser. Unless you're reading the book, in which case it's not blood.
Right.
Let's see. I hope I did that the correct way, but we'll see.
Come on, Thomas.
I heard they're redoing Hellraiser.
Oh no. No. Why? Nobody will ever be as good as the Pinhead that they got for Pinhead.
Mm-hmm. Why do the removal men have American accents?
That is true.
Especially since one of them is a well-known British character actor.
Well, yeah. Thomas, we went on without you. We're done.
Oh wow! You guys saw the mystery already.
We solved it.
I got 25 to life.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I sanded too.
My character got raped by the prison guards.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay. We know what the moment is. We can cut this all out. All right, you were talking to Dexter at the moment. Yeah.
What was I talking to Dexter about?
It was just about, if I'm correctly remember, we were talking about your going into talking about joining.
You're going to talk to Daniel Radley. I'm completely out of character now. You're going to speak with Daniel.
Give it a moment.
You want to give it a moment? Okay.
Yeah. And then get yourself back into character, and then I can cut all this out.
Okay, that's good.
Just so I know, I can kind of make some notes. Who's Daniel Radley and connection? He's...
I don't think
we just know. So I know.
No. You guys don't know yet. You're about to know.
Okay. Yeah, I said, yeah, that sounds good.
Daniel Radley, a friend of mine.
Okay.
He has just been detained by the police in conjunction with the disappearance of an acquaintance of his, Mr. Lee Baldwin, apparently. He and another acquaintance are currently being held at the Arkham Police Station.
Sorry, what's his name? Lee.
The victim's name was Lee Baldwin.
Okay.
I don't know the name of the other acquaintance. I'm sorry. I only spoke with Daniel for a few moments before the police shooed me away. But I've hired on some friends of mine who are very adept at knowing certain things. And they'll also have the answers to what happened to Caleb and the others.
Okay. That sounds really good, Amelia. But when I'm just looking around. I want to see if I can, you know, see if I can find anything, you know, out of the ordinary or anything that kind of just as a quick glance about.
Well, I mean, the mirror fused to the wall is one sign of something that's a little odd. And also the giant blood stain that can't come out of the carpet is also another sign that something went down in here. That's a little odd. Other than that, no, there's nothing really
okay
going on in here.
I'm going to ask. So are you okay, Miss Court? I mean, you had a gun out when we walked in.
She chuckles and says, you never know who's following you nowadays.
Do you feel threatened? Like, is there somebody out there right now, or you're just being extra cautious?
Extra cautious.
Okay.
Mr. Hawk, when you meet with him at the police station, he'll be able to tell you everything you need to know.
Okay. Well, I apologize, and I didn't mean to put you off guard like that.
And she just nods.
Can I ask you one other question?
She nods and says yes.
Did you know Caleb personally?
She says, I didn't know him very well, but from what I did know about him, he was a good person. And I know that the papers said that he was, because he was a student, he was involved in that cult, but he wasn't.
Okay. I thank you for that. Cause that's what I'm trying to find out. He was a good friend of mine, and things that I've heard stories about and rumors flying around. And that's what I'm hoping to find out is I just can't believe some of the things they're saying about him.
Yeah.
Well, you won't believe the actual story when you hear it from the other three.
Oh.
Okay. Yeah. That sounds okay. Yes. Yeah, sorry about that. We walked in, barged in, and you were.
She holds up her hand and says, "It's fine."
Okay, well,
shall we leave, Mr. Fowler?
Yeah, I think we got most of what we, you know, starting of what we need. Thank you so much, Amelia.
She says, please head to the police station as soon as possible so that you can meet with Mr. Hawk, the others, and, of course, Daniel.
Okay. Roughly how quick? Tonight?
Immediately, if you can.
Sorry, did she offer to pay?
Yep.
So is she hiring you, Mr. Fowler? She's not hiring me.
I think, you know what? I think she's hiring me, but I give you sort of a little cut in the of it.
Like a nudge and a wink. Like, hey, come with me, buddy. I'm going to show you some stuff.
Yeah, that's basically what.
Cool. Okay.
I do.
All right. So you guys head to the police station.
Yeah.
As we're walking down the hallway, I kind of wipe my brow and I say, "You almost got shot."
You almost got shot.
Amelia Court, lovely as ever. So you guys head to the station. So Hawk, Thompson, and Sterling pretty much arrive at the exact same time. You guys kind of enter into the bullpen, and you're instructed by an officer to just wait until Sergeant Cagno approves you guys to go talk with Mr. Radley and the other culprit.
Sergeant Cagno.
Hawk, give me a listen roll.
Sure. Fifteen. Very good.
Now I'm going to ask you, did you or anyone in your group, which includes Sterling and Thompson, try and tell anybody the truth?
For me, no.
What about Henry and Trent?
Did I tell them the truth? Or no, you're asking them. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I'm asking if they told the truth, what actually happened.
The only person that would sort of know would be Baxter.
Okay.
Me, but nobody else knows.
All right. What about you, Trent?
Some reason I couldn't get a hold of Lenora. She seemed to have disappeared out of nowhere.
No, I wouldn't have brought it up at all.
Okay. So then, Hawk, what you hear around you is officers and detectives kind of muttering amongst themselves, saying, like, those are the guys that, you know, that pulled Amelia Court out of the cult shooting back in October. And they kind of look at the three of you with a sort of reverence. Like, they're not going to get in your way. You guys are kind of like legends.
And I'm just kind of indifferent to their hero worship.
Yeah, and that's when Trenton and Henry, you kind of notice that too, that there's a lot of like stolen glances and people looking at you and then whispering amongst themselves.
I actually find it a bit unnerving. Although if I'm hearing the whispers, I'll sort of ignore it just like Hawk is doing, but I don't like.
I say to the others, my crew there, I'm like, well, let's hope that it at least gives us some clout with the Sergeant Cagno. I don't know him.
That's the way I look at it.
If he's as enamored, then he won't get in our way.
That's when, Hawk, you hear footsteps behind you, and you turn around to see a Mr. Dexter Fowler and some kid that he's brought along. Hawk, you know Dexter Fowler. He's a famous private investigator, while you're just some little nobody.
And Dexter Fowler, holy crap.
Clifton Hawk, how are you doing?
Wow, I'm surprised you know my name.
I have connections that are... I have connections.
Oh, wow. What are you doing in this neighborhood?
Well, he came to investigate Daniel Radley.
Well, that just happens to be who we're here to talk to. Who's your friend?
I'll let you introduce him to you guys. I think his name's Tommy.
Tommy Anderson, sir.
Mr. Anderson, Clifton Hawk.
Nice to meet you.
I hope this should be interesting.
This isn't the place and time now, but I hope to ask you guys some questions when we get out of here.
Sure.
So, Fowler, I need you to do a spot hidden, please.
Okay.
Dexter Fowler, I'm really surprised.
No, I don't. I fail horribly.
Okay. You look at Hawk, who in the PI industry of Arkham now, or New England, is kind of a deadbeat. No one really gives a shit about Hawk anymore. But you kind of look at him and you see that he looks a little worn down. Maybe he's not been sleeping very well.
Okay. I say, you look kind of... I basically try and see how he's doing. I ask him a few questions and then... Are you okay? I heard some things happened a few months ago that you've not...
No, I'm fine. Don't listen to everything you hear.
And Trent and Henry also kind of hear this conversation as they're kind of in your little gaggle.
I guess I should sort of introduce you. This is Trent Sterling and Henry Thompson. Henry Thompson's a professor at the university. Trent is just a regular nice guy.
I go up and shake their hands. I'm like, I think we'll be working together, guys.
So you guys hear a door open and you see a man wearing a gray suit, and you can just automatically assume this is Sergeant Cagno. When he approaches Hawk and he says, Clifton Hawk, I've got your witnesses in the back room. And he looks at Corey and he says, Mr. Fowler. And he immediately shakes his hand and says, it's an honor to have you in my to have you here in the bullpen.
Thanks.
Sergeant Hawk, thank you. And you sitting right in here?
He then says, yes, follow me. And he walks you into the back room and you see the double pane glass, and you look in and you see two people. You see Daniel Radley from the description mm-hmm. that Amelia gave you, and then some other person sitting there at the table. And he says, you can just go through the door right there.
Now, is the other person some other prisoner? Or
He was the acquaintance. He's the other person that was at, there that night with Lee.
I see.
And,
I see. Yeah. So there was another acquaintance there.
Yes. All Someone right. else knew, saw what happened. Cagno then says, I can't let you guys stay here for that long. The chief, he doesn't like hearing that you three are here. And he points to Hawk, Trent, and Henry. And he says, I'll keep him off, though. Don't worry. You go ahead and talk to him. And he walks out.
I don't know. I'm going to purposefully sort of step in front of Dexter and if there's a chair there at the table, just to immediately take it.
All right. So, Felix, you and Daniel have been sitting there for what seems like 15 minutes, pretty much chained up to this table, when the door opens and in come five men.
Mr. Radley, our mutual friend Amelia Court sent me to discuss the situation with you. You requested Mr. Trent, Mr. Sterling.
Hello,
he nods. He says, "Thank you for coming. We've been here," and he looks at Felix and he says, "We've been here for all day. We've been here for 24 hours."
Yeah, I hope to God one of you's got a cigarette on them.
And you are?
Epstein, Felix Epstein. You may know me better as the Great Bamboni.
Oh,
holy crap! The Great Bamboni.
Yeah, I've been playing here.
You're a magician.
That's right, sir. I certainly am.
I am a magician.
So am I to understand that you were present at this the disappearance of Mr. Lee Baldwin, yes?
By present, I mean I was in the hall with Mr. Radley when the incident occurred, yeah.
Okay, so I think the obvious question has to be, Did you make him disappear?
I go up to say, Clifton, I don't think this is the exact moment to actually make jokes about that.
You thought that was a joke, did you?
Yes.
No, but I wish I could pull something off as cleanly as this. I mean, I'm
sorry for asking.
I'm at a loss to explain what happened there.
It was the great Bambini. What was it?
Bamboni. The great Bamboni.
This is when Daniel, who's like sweating convulsively because he's freaked out because he's never been arrested before, says, "Listen, the police don't believe us when we tell you this, but Lee was in the guest bedroom, and then there was a fight, and then he was gone."
A fight?
Yeah.
Who fought? Well,
something happened in there. There was a sound of furniture crashing about, and I mean, when we went into the room, we didn't just open the door. There was a big heavy wooden bed frame up against the door. I mean, it took both of us with all our strength a couple of goes to push the door in.
We looked around.
Had to break the lock and push this thing out of the way.
Sorry, the great Bamboni. Does he have any enemies?
Lee? He looks at Felix and says he was talking bad about Carmichael. He snaps and he says, "We were a little drunk, so I'm sorry. It's not entirely there. We went and we saw a play. Me and Lee. I know him from New York. And Felix here was sitting by us, and we saw the play. It's called Sodom.
All right, stop. I need you to take a deep breath. I need you to calm down a bit. Let's start from the beginning."
He nods and he says, "We came home to my mansion and sat down."
You went to see a play. What was it called? Sodom?
Sodom.
As in Sodom and Gomorrah?
Yeah. And he looks at Felix.
It was pretty awful. So the Angelica, where I'm.
Yeah.
That's I got some free tickets from the owner.
Yeah, it's a play put on by. It's a play put on by Anthony Carmichael. Lee was a producer on the show. He gave some money, and he was a little pissed off that it tanked. So he was drinking. We were all drinking.
Carmichael, why does that name sound familiar? Is he a?
He's a popular a producer in New York.
Okay.
He's made a couple plays.
I remember the name.
He's successful before this.
Now, was Lee all through the night? Was Lee acting like nervous, shaky, kind of not himself? Or do you know Lee that much?
No, he was a. No, I mean, he was just drunk and he was angry, right, Felix?
Yeah, I mean, you know, he'd had a bad night. There was the play hadn't gone well. It wasn't very well. It was awful. You know, it was awful. He knew it was awful. I think he was pissed with Carmichael and with himself for putting his money into it. It was just, you know, it was a bad lot, and he'd realized that, I think.
Yeah, fair enough. I just want to get all the facts straight before we, just so that you guys were there. And
well, Mr. Radley, what's your relationship with Mr. Baldwin?
Like I said, we're just acquaintances in We're just acquaintances in New York. I know him from some parties. I actually met him at the courts in Providence. That's how I know Amelia. Me and Amelia we're actually good friends. My family knows hers.
Okay.
And
that's how I know Trent. And
so it's just a party thing, an acquaintance you met at a party, and you. What's your relationship then with Mr. Epstein? The same thing.
I said he was just an acquaintance I met at the show, and yeah, we were drinking, and I thought we'd go back to each
other. All right. Mr. Epstein, do you have any acquaintance with Mr. Baldwin?
Before last night? No, none at all. No, we've never met before.
Okay.
You know, we, I'm a traveling entertainer.
All right.
People strike up conversation. I spend the night with different people. That's just my life.
So after you arrive back at your place, Mr. Radley, describe what happened after that, please, in detail.
Well, like I said, we went back to my mansion and we had some drinks. Then Lee was drunk and I didn't want him or Mr. Epstein to drive, so I let them come stay up in our guest rooms. And we all went to sleep. And then, what was it?
What time was this? Do you know?
It was about 10 o'clock.
And this is after you saw this play, Sodom.
Sodom, yes.
Okay.
And we went to bed, and that was it. And then at 2 o'clock in the morning, I hear this blood-curdling scream, and he's crying out for help. And I opened the door, and my servants were looking out of their door, and Mr. Epstein was looking out his, and we just ran to the second guest room and tried to get in.
And Mr. Epstein, you said that it was blocked with something?
Well, it was locked. We sent, Mr. Radley sent one of the maids to get the key. Then there was a shout from inside. Mr. Baldwin seemed to be in distress, so we started barging the door down, and we busted the lock, but there was something behind the door, so we had to both of us push together to get the door open.
Now, did you guys move anything in the room? Because we might want to check out the room.
Well,
move
the room,
like touch anything in the room, do anything to disturb the.
Well, the room was trashed. It was there was debris everywhere.
Do you know what it was?
There was a big oak bed frame that had been broken, and part of it was in front of the door. We had to push that out of the way in order to get into the room. So that we moved that. Yeah.
I just want to know: did you move anything out of the room, just so that you know, in case you know, you want to go check it out, that we can, you know,
we didn't take anything out of the room. No, we searched the room for Mr. Baldwin.
What about the rock? And he kind of shuffles over to you.
That was kind of weird. No, it's still in the room.
Rock.
I didn't pick it up. Yeah, I found this stone. Well, I thought when I first saw it, I thought it was a stone.
Or a pebble or something. Was it smooth? Different, a weird color.
Here's the thing. It was kind of gray, and it looked kind of marble-ish, but it wasn't marble. But it was when I looked at it with the flashlight, I turned it over with my pencil. I didn't touch it in case there were fingerprints on it, but It's just, you know, you read a lot of mystery novels, and there's something out of place is always the clue, isn't it? So it just, yes. You know, it struck me at the time. I thought, there's this thing, it's on the floor. Maybe I'll have a look at it. Maybe it's something, maybe it's not. I don't know. You know, so I had a look at it. I turned it over, and it's like, it was a fingertip, like from a statue or something.
From a statue?
Yeah. Which just struck me as a strange thing. I mean, maybe it was like some lucky charm that the guy kept on him or something. I don't know.
And it was made out of stone of some sort. You say gray?
Yeah, some sort of gray stone. I mean, I'm
life size or bigger or smaller or.
It was about an inch and a half. It looked like a human fingertip, like mine.
Yeah. Yeah.
Weird.
I mean, it looked well made. I mean, it looked like a, you know, like a. It looked like a fingertip. It wasn't crudely.
How long have you gentlemen been in here?
24 hours. This happened last night.
Okay. You should not have been incarcerated at all. Yeah. You have multiple witnesses, do you not? Your maids, your butlers, your servants.
My maids, Bree and Danielle Clark. They should still be up there. They should be cleaning up the room. Actually, I don't know.
That's not. We should. I have to. We need to get your phone number immediately.
Look, one of you guys gonna give me a smoke or what?
Well, okay. Certainly. We'll go. I hand him a cigar.
Chesterfield.
Just a cigarette.
Well,
Chesterfield.
Yeah. Sorry, I don't have any smokes. I just have a cigar.
Chesterfield. Here you go.
Yep. I'll have one.
I say I need to get your number immediately. We need to tell him to stop cleaning up the room.
I can have someone send a telegram out, but the thing is that we've been in here, and they say that they may release Felix, but they said they're not going to let me out. They say that there's no conclusive evidence that I wasn't involved because there's no way out of the room.
Well, that's ridiculous. We were both outside the room. We were both in the hall. We both had to hammer the door down. We could hear him inside and had to hammer the door down to get into the room. And then he was gone. And
but he's gone. He's just gone.
Believe me, I know trap doors. Right? There were no trap doors.
There were no latches.
The windows were painted shut. There was like layers and layers of paint on the window. Mr. Radley tried to open the window. He could barely get it to even move.
This room? Describe the entire room to us.
Is there a fireplace in the room?
Maybe you went to upside down.
No.
No, there was like a vanity. There's a little bathroom off the side of it that was smashed up as well. There was a closet that was empty. There was a bed and a few other. I don't know what kind of furniture was in there. I mean, it was all just broken up. You know, it was. I couldn't tell you what had been in there.
Also,
excuse me for a few moments. I'll be back, and I'm gonna go out.
Just one more thing before I head out, just so I know. What is Lee's... Do you have an address as of his last location?
Of Lee's location?
Of his house.
His house is in New York. But my
does
house...
He have, does he have any... I meant anything. Does he have a house here or rent anything here? Where did he stay last?
Well, he was probably going to stay with me regardless. Like I said, me and him, he's up here touring with the show. He could be, he's either going to stay with me or he was going to stay at that hotel in South Arkham with Carmichael.
Okay. I just want to know, maybe I could find something there. Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to jump to Hawk, who's walking outside. So, Hawk, where are you going?
I'm going to ask why they have been detained, on what grounds Have they been detained for 24 hours when there are obviously witnesses placing them in no way inside the room? They can't just hold them on suspicion when they've got alibis. Is there some other detective who's thinks that he's smart and something, and he's an idiot?
So you walk outside and you see Sergeant Cagno, and he's talking to someone who's in uniform blues, and he's saying, "Look, just give him a few minutes." And this guy says, "I don't want excuses. I want them out of here now. Release Mr. Epstein, but keep Radley here." And you can see that from his regalia, he's the chief.
Do I know him?
You know who he is, but you've never had the pleasure. But you do know that him and Dean Fallon from Crimson Letters are very close-knit.
Do I know his name?
Yeah, his name is Chief Mason.
Chief Mason. Oh, another Mason. I'm tired of Masons.
Chief Archer Mason. Yeah.
Chief Archer Mason. So I'm going into the danger zone.
Yes.
So okay. I walk up and I go, "Oh, well, hello, Archer."
He then says, "I want you gone, Hawk."
"I'm sorry, but you aren't the god of the police, and we've got some problems here. Neither one of these men, you don't have the right to hold these men the way you've been holding them. You're Radley and the great Bamboni, and they have the Bamboni is what he said to me. He said both they have the servants in the house and the maids to tell you that they were not in the room when it was being trashed by someone. Probably who came through the window. You don't have enough evidence to hold them. And Mr. Radley has quite a high, credit rating in our town."
"Mr. Hawk, I need you to understand that, yeah, there's not enough evidence to say that he did it. But there's also no evidence suggesting that he didn't do it.
This country, we are innocent until we are proven guilty. That's the law, and you know that's the law. We are investigating. I promise you, we are investigating. We have Mr. Dexter Fowler in the other room. We're going to find out what happened here, I assure you. And there's no chance that this guy's going to run."
He sighs and then says, "Release both of them."
"Thank you. You are indeed a reasonable man."
He points at you, Hawk, and he says, "If you do anything to piss me off again, Hawk, you're done." And he walks away.
Okay.
Nice guy.
I tell Sergeant Cagno, I say, you can reassure Chief Mason that I will disclose any information that we come up with to you." So
he nods, right, and he says, "Well, let's go release the others."
All right. So I go back with you.
Okay. So you guys are talking about the case when Cagno enters into the room, and he says, "Mr. Epstein and Mr. Radley, you're free to go." And Radley goes, "Oh, thank God."
"I wanted to say it."
Goodness for that. I've been wearing this penguin suit for nearly 30 hours.
Gentlemen, hopefully, can we go someplace? Can we please go back to Mr. Radley's estate and continue our conversation there?
Happy to do that, but I'd really appreciate the opportunity to stop by my hotel for a change of clothes. I mean,
sounds really good, but we just want to get this done. I understand that you must be exhausted from these from this, you know, being held here, but I want to get this done.
Well, Mr. Fowler, would you perhaps accompany? Sorry, would you, Mr. Fowler, would you perhaps accompany?
Is it possible for me to just?
We keep cutting each other off.
Yeah. Ready, Tom.
I know. Thomas. There's a little bit of lag on my end. Yeah. There's a little bit of lag. Right. So go ahead.
Mr. Fowler, would you consider accompanying Mr. Epstein back to his apartment and letting him clean up? And then we'll all meet at Mr. Radley's residence.
Yeah, you know what? That sounds good. I'm pretty sure that's fine with me. What about either Mr. Epstein or the great Bambino? Or Bambino, or whatever your name is.
Mr. Epstein's just fine by me. I'm not on stage right now. So, I mean, I just need a bit of a wash and a shave and a change of clothes, really. I mean, I'm still dressed for the theater, you know?
Is it actually possible?
Carlo's getting a bit tight, to be honest.
is it possible for us to actually meet tomorrow? I've been in here for what seems like ages, and I just want sleep.
We prefer tonight. I understand you need a rest, but I wouldn't like it. I'm very thorough. I want to get this done.
There may be, I hate to actually alarm you, but there may be something going on here that might put you all at risk. So I would rather that neither one of you is alone for any length of time. Of course, if you're in a bedroom in the house, that's fine. But I think that there should be somebody there with you.
Why? And he says, I know that when I talked to Amelia, she said that she'd contact you people because you people deal with this stuff. But what's there to worry about? I mean, he's got to be somewhere.
It's what we don't know that's the problem. And
if what's it called? Sorry to budge in there, Hawk. But if that thing happened to Lee, then it might happen to you. I'm not going to say it will.
And he.
But I.
Well, then I imagine, Mr. Fowler, that if something happens to me, you'll solve the case.
I'll solve the case. No, I'm talking to Lee or to Daniel. About that.
Well, we have to research this, so.
No, yeah.
So Radley then looks at the group and nods and says, you can all just stay with me then. How about that? There's plenty of rooms in the mansion. You can have full access to the house. And I can sleep. Yes,
and you can rest. And yes, that sounds acceptable. That way we can look through.
I mean, if we're going to do that, I could easily just pick up my. I mean, most of my equipment's at the theater anyway, so I could just pick up my suitcases, and that would only take a moment.
So Mr. Fowler, you go with him to his place to pick up his stuff, and we'll all meet there in what, 30 minutes?
Yeah, that can work. Sure. I don't know if Felix needs more time or not, but
I can pick up my stuff and I can have a wash and change when we get to
Trent, Henry, you in?
I'm in, definitely.
Excellent. All right, so let's do that.
So everyone is going to the house. All righty. Mm-hmm. So let's cut to that. We're going to say that you all just drive up to the house and you all pull up pretty much at around the same time. It's now, at about this time, it's like morning, because it was late when all this was going down anyways. So it's like dawn.
Okay.
It's about 5 o'clock in the morning. The sun is just barely peeking over the horizon. As you guys pull up in your cars, you can see that there are two maids, and they're standing at the front door.
Okay. Well, I'm with Radley. What's his reaction?
Yeah.
Does he say, "Good morning, ladies," sir?
He gets out and he says, "Bree, Danielle, these here are some investigators. They're coming to check in on what happened to Lee. If you could just allow them access to the majority of the home, that would be very nice." And he nods and he turns to you, Hawk, and he says, I'm going to go to bed." And he nods, right. And he walks up the steps and he walks into the house.
All right. Would you mind if I walked with you so that I can see where you're going to be? And all right. I just want to know where
he says yes. Why don't you all follow me, anyways?
All right.
I'll tell you about the house and where everything is.
I'm just going to carry my suitcase to the same room I was in last night.
Okay. So, for those of you that aren't familiar with the house, so he leads you inside, and very first thing that you see is to the right is a drawing room. The drawing room has nothing really in it. You can see that it's got a carpet and some old furniture kind of pushed off to the side. And kind of this rectangular domed mirror. To your left is a parlor. The parlor is in better condition. There's a fireplace. There's this big old mirror hanging over it. Kind of old furniture. It's a little stingy. There's a radio, a cabinet radio in one corner. You can also see miscellaneous moving boxes kind of all over in that room. He then says, now down over here, down this hall, you can see that's the dining room. And he points, and it's a huge dining room, extravagant even. And he says, and here is the library. This door here leads to the library, which attaches to my study, or I suppose the person who owned this place's study. And then down this hall, if you continue going down it and then you make a left, you'll be in the ballroom.
Wow.
And then, of course, if you follow me, and he leads you up the stairs, and he takes everyone up to the second floor. And on the second floor, it's kind of open concept. There's no real hallway. He says, this here is the master bedroom. Right across from it is the first guest room. Over here, he points to the room next to the master. This is the servants' quarters. This is where Danielle and Bree sleep. And then here, he points to the room across the way. This is where it all happened. This was the room Lee was staying in.
Like the second guest room.
Yeah. And he says, there are more guest rooms up on the third floor, along with a wood room.
What's a wood room?
It's a lumber room. It holds essentially like loose boards for building. Yeah. I think a loose door in there. There's this broken wardrobe. But then of course moving boxes, but there's no lights up in there.
Okay.
I haven't installed any. And then there's three guest rooms up on the third floor that you are all more than happy to use.
That sounds good. I'm going to look inside the room where it happened. Is stuff still there or
is they clean it up? Is Felix staying in the first guest room?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. So I'm going with Dexter.
Okay. Where does everyone else go? Radley's going to sleep, and the maids are going to go prepare breakfast.
Radley is in the master bedroom.
Yes. Yes. Radley's in the master bedroom.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going to have a few hours sleep. I didn't get much sleep in the.
All right. So I guess if they're going to bed, then Dexter and I and whoever, everybody else, we're going to go into the room where Lee disappeared.
Makes sense. Also, if you know we're doing the investigating in the room, I hand Clifton a pair of gloves.
I have a pair.
I have a pair. I hand anybody else a pair of gloves if they're going to be in the same room as us to investigate, just so we don't mess up any fingerprints and stuff like that.
Well, at the time, fingerprinting was almost non-existent, so there would be no need to worry about putting your fingerprints on a crime scene.
1930s?
Yeah, well, fingerprinting wasn't really a thing until after the war. It began in 35.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but there's no need to worry about contamination.
Okay.
Could you describe the war room for us?
So it is a 12 by 10 room. It is completely destroyed.
Okay.
Like, there's... The mattress is really only now fabric, springs, and feathers. The solid oak bed frame has been literally snapped and twisted and broken into just splinters all over the room.
Do you suppose could have the kind of force that it would take to do something like that is astonishing?
It's incredible, yes. There are broken nightstands that also look like they were made of solid oak. Broken glass from the lamp up on the ceiling. There you can see broken stained glass on the floor from maybe a lamp on the nightstand. You can also see that the paintings. Oh, go ahead.
Well, let me ask this. Okay, it's a rectangle. Yes, you said 12, 10 by 12. Okay. If I were to draw a rectangle. Okay. So we got north, south, east, and west. Where is the door that we're coming in?
Okay. The door that you're coming in is on the east side.
Okay. East side. Okay. Like right in the middle.
Don't worry. You guys will have a map next. Yeah.
Okay.
You guys will have a map next session, so you don't need to worry about.
All right, I won't worry about it then.
Yeah. Okay. Now, whereabouts is that rock?
We'll have to look around for it because they've gone to bed.
I think he's frozen again.
Okay.
All right, let's pause for a moment. 7:31.
What's going on in Dallas?
I don't know, but sorry if I'm kind of taking the reins of this first episode.
Well, it goes with your character if he's...
I think you and I are a little in cooperation in competition.
No, it's okay. Okay,
you were gone for a long time there, Thomas.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you were frozen.
I'd
asked you about what you said that the door was on the east.
To finish this
map, so that's the last thing you said. It's a lot of lag.
Yeah.
Is he frozen again?
There is a lot of lag. I'm gonna jump out and come back in.
Okay.
I have no idea what's going on with my internet right now. So, yeah. Give me one sec.
Yeah, like I said, my character, he's kind of wanted to be the center of attention, and
so does my character now.
Which makes it fun.
Yeah,
I know. I'm pretty sure we will be butting heads pretty soon. But
do we know why you're famous there, Clifton or Dexter?
He's been on tons of cases, and all about 98% of the cases he's done, he's like, you know, solved the case. And
you're from New York?
And I'm from New York. So
high profile.
And
like a celebrity detective or something like that.
And it's just sort of like celebrities, people who have a lot of money, they pay him. The rich and famous people will pay him, and then he gets them done, like, you know, faster than most other.
Maybe later he moves to Chicago, and they make a musical about him getting Roxy Hart off the.
That's basically all you know about.
You guys are also in the room with us, so if you guys want to just interject some comment.
I'm wandering, making notes.
I'm snoring loudly at the end of the hall.
I'm looking for artifacts. Something that doesn't belong.
But
like a stone finger.
You know what?
Where did the stone finger go?
You said it was on the floor. They saw it with a flashlight, so.
Yeah, but I'm liking this so far. It sounds really interesting. Oh.
I'm a law student. Shit. I was blown away to see how law is actually handled in the police room when you, and Mr. Hawk there, when you told them to just release them.
Just one second.
Yeah.
Like, hey, what's up?
That's not how you do it. That's not by the book.
I see his tentacle.
Not so much right now.
Your tentacle's showing.
I will be there at 9. Okay.
How am I now? Guys? Am I any better?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, I'll be
there. That's
the
good.
The question is how much lag.
What are we going to do tonight?
Not a whole lot of lag on my end.
All right. That's good.
For now.
All right. Corey's on the phone. He'll be off in a second.
All right. Let's keep going. Let's see how far we can get. All right. So, don't worry about where the doors are. You guys are going to get a map. I didn't think you guys were going to get this far, actually.
Mm.
So, yeah. So the map's not finished, but I'm going to have a map for you guys. Okay. And we'll do what we kind of did with Pathfinder, where I'll put the map up and I can show you guys where you all are on the screen.
Okay.
All right. So, finishing up with the description, you can see that there are two doors. They're both open. One leads to a bathroom. One leads to an empty closet. You can see that the maids, Mr. Radley called them in the middle of cleaning up. They put the pictures and the mirror back on the wall.
All right.
Of this room.
Okay.
I believe Mr. Thompson is looking around the room.
Okay. Mr. Thompson, you don't really find anything of interest until you push over some splinters and you find the rock that Mr. Radley was speaking about.
All right. So, is there any...
Do you pick it up?
I say, just wait one second there. Sorry, your name is Henry?
Yes.
Professor Thompson.
Or Professor Thompson, I'm very sorry. Is there any way we can, you know, not touch Doc right now?
Are we not?
Well, I would like to...
Since he just told me not to touch the rock, I'm going to pick up the rock.
Yeah. Thompson, in looking at the rock, you see that it's a grayish color. It looks to be made of marble, but you know that it's not marble. It's something else. It's got the color of just a normal stone, but it's nice and smooth.
Even the finger. I'm not touching it. Sorry.
Yeah, you can see that it looks exactly like a fingertip. Go ahead.
How heavy is it? Does it feel like the weight of a finger would feel, or is it heavier? Is it lighter?
It's a little heavier than what you imagine a fingertip would be.
Okay. I'm just testing the weight. Yeah. I turn it over. I look at the fingertip. Does it look like it has fingerprints on it?
If you give me a spot hit,
is it like engraved with like fingertips?
Yeah, go ahead and give me a spot hit.
And that is a 10.
Yeah, you hold it up to your old wise eyes, and you can see that there are thin, light etchings of a fingerprint.
Okay. Now, this finger, does it look like it's been severed, I guess? Would there be any
Like bone? Right where the joint is, it's completely flat. Like, it's completely smooth.
Okay. Hmm.
I kind of look at it. And I'm like, interesting.
Mr. Hawk, you were saying?
I just was going to say, Professor Thompson, is there anything interesting about it?
Yes, it is. It seems, and I'll hand it to you and show you the engravings. It looks like an actual finger, like maybe.
And I quietly sort of say to him, I say, no sculptor puts fingerprints on it.
I know. The area where the fingerprint was, is there anything else in that immediate area? Anything at all?
Other than wood splinters and large chunks of wood and feathers and the materials that made up the bed and some glass, no.
Glass.
Yeah, glass from the light above and maybe some lamps.
Are there any other fragments of what look like stone? Something broken or...
Nope.
I don't look, but I sort of glance up at the mirror, only because I absolutely detest mirrors at this point.
Is there a problem? Because I'm guessing you're kind of...
None whatsoever.
No? You're not driving expressions about the mirrors or anything like that?
I have no problem with mirrors whatsoever.
Okay.
You look up at the mirror, and you can see that it's just... It looks like a normal mirror. Glass in the frame. It's like an oval. The frame is this kind of say it's a darkish blue. It's like a darkish blue.
Wood painted.
Looks like did you say the paintings or the
no? Painting I said is it just like wood that's been painted blue?
No, oh no! It looks like it's actually like a metal. It looks kind of like if jade were blue.
Oh, that's interesting.
That is interesting. Okay. Is there? I kind of want to check. I look up at the ceiling. Is there anything on the ceiling? Any burn marks? Any damage on the ceiling.
Nope. What are Trent and Tommy doing? I don't think that they're in this room.
I think, aren't they? I thought they were.
Yeah, I thought they followed us.
Yeah, we followed as well.
Okay.
I'm kind of standing in the doorway because I'm not quite sure what I'm supposed to be doing. I mean, just Tommy. He doesn't know how to investigate or anything like that. So I'm just kind of watching.
Jeff, I need you to give me a listen roll.
Okay. Pass. Regular.
Is someone talking? And you look around, and someone's talking, but you can't quite make out what they're saying, and you don't know where it's coming from.
I'll step out of the room into the hallway and see if I could locate it.
Yeah, you can hear it's coming from. It's definitely coming from downstairs.
Downstairs. We're on the second floor now, right?
Correct.
Yep.
And Epstein is on the second floor?
Yep.
Actually, everybody should be on the second floor.
Except for the maids who are in the kitchen, which is in the basement.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Trent's next to me or near me. Trent, do you hear that? Do you hear that?
Do I hear that?
Do you hear any voices?
Do I hear anything?
Nope, Trent doesn't hear anything.
No, I don't hear anything. Just the guys in the room.
And you guys kind of hear this conversation, you know, of Tommy going, does anyone hear anything?
Mr. Anderson?
No, I thought I heard somebody downstairs. Maybe breakfast is ready.
Well, let's go take a look. The room's a little full of people.
Yeah, I think, you know what? I think, is it okay if me and Clifton go just check it out and you guys go down, you know, downstairs?
No.
You want to stay in the room or you want to go down and actually check out?
No, I was thinking, you know, I'll stay in this room, you know, just doing some final checking out, see if there's any more things left in this room.
And you stay, I'll go downstairs and check. I'll go with Mr. Anderson.
Okay. So,
that sounds good. I just want to make sure I have a person with me just in case I don't want this to happen to me.
And as I step out with Mr. Anderson, are you armed?
Maybe.
Well, I would suggest that you be armed.
Yes, I am. Sorry.
Are you a good shot?
Yeah, actually, I'm not too bad. My father was a police officer.
Good. Well, let's keep our wits about us, but there's some foul and strange things going on here that I think, I don't know what they are, but foul and strange.
Yeah, you think we're in danger, maybe?
I don't get called in on these things if there's not something weird.
Trent, Henry, and Hawk, you guys have this feeling in the pit of your stomach.
Yeah.
This has happened before.
I always have this feeling in the pit of my stomach.
Yeah.
I probably have a massive ulcer.
You guys kind of know, you guys have a nagging suspicion that you guys know what's going on.
Hmm.
It's not something good.
Where did I get myself into?
Fate. So you guys go down, everyone goes downstairs but Fowler. So what happens is you guys, you know, you wander downstairs and Tommy, you go down the stairs and you hear it's coming from around the hallway corner.
Okay.
Do you kind of lead everyone down there?
Yeah, I'll kind of actually like quietly
Can we hear it at this point?
Hmm?
Do we hear it at this point?
Nope.
You hear something, but we can't hear it. That's that sounds pretty normal for our cases. All right. I've got my gun.
I have my sword.
Okay.
All I have is my sword, Ken, because a shotgun's kind of hard to carry around.
All right.
And I'm taken aback at all of a sudden these gentlemen standing next to me start pulling out weapons. I'm like...
Oh, I always have my cane, so...
All right. So, Clifton, Tommy, Trent, and Henry, you guys turn the corner, and what you see... And Hawk, especially you, get this like feeling of a long hallway, and there's a single door at the end of this hallway, and there's only one light in this hallway, so it's pretty much, and there's no windows, so it's pretty much pitch black.
If that song, I don't want to set the world on fire, starts playing, I am going to freak out. All right. So we hear, now, we don't hear, but Tommy hears something.
I'm going to, like, hold up my hand to, like, have everybody stop, and then I'll listen. Do I still hear?
Yes. But also what you hear, the four of you, you begin hearing a piano. Just soft keys. Nice.
That's always good.
Hmm.
I think it's time for me to go back home for the evening, gentlemen.
The freaking music room. All right.
Maid's on the break.
Well, in for a pound, in for another pound, or whatever the phrase is. I'm going to step forward and open the door. If I'm somewhere with gigantic blue tentacles in the sky, I'm going to freak out.
What was that, Trent?
I'm readying my cane in preparation, stepping back.
Okay. So as you approach, you guys have this every step you take, you can feel dread washing over you. It's very palpable. It's very real. It's like you're walking through molasses, essentially. Like, you're like, I don't want to go. I need everyone who's approaching the door to go make a power check.
I make it.
Yes, so do I.
I miss it by three.
I got a 10.
Ooh. All right. Nice. Let me read this really quick. Hawk, you have the sudden urge to run.
Okay, I am.
There is something behind that door, and you don't want to be on the other side of it. And at this point, you do hear the whispers.
Okay. Guys, I changed my mind. I'm going to go back and back to the other room. And I'm sort of like backing away from the door.
Oh, come on. We've been through worse.
I don't know. Maybe it's shell shock. I think I'm going to throw up. I need to go. I just got to back. Sorry, I can't go through that door. Sorry.
I'll walk up to the door. I'll grab the sword off.
And you walk up to the door and you turn the handle and you can kind of hear the piano still playing. It's quicker and quicker and quicker. And he opens the door. Note stops. Mid note, piano stops playing. You open the door, and what you see is this almost pitch black ballroom. It's huge. It's magnificent. There's columns that line the sides of the walls. There are huge draperies that are blocking out the windows. There's a piano set to one corner. It's enormous.
See? Empty.
Empty?
Well,
I thought the ballroom was downstairs.
We are downstairs.
Yeah.
Ballroom is downstairs, oh. Yes.
We went downstairs?
Yeah. Yes, we did.
Oh.
Yes.
I believe you. Go ahead.
Trent led you downstairs.
Oh, my God.
Is there a light switch?
Don't tell anybody I'm such a fucking old woman.
Secret's safe with us. It's understandable. From what we've all been through, it's all good.
Mr. Anderson, you know that we've seen some pretty terrible things, so...
Well, that's right. When we get a chance, I still need to talk to you about that.
All right.
Who goes into the ballroom?
Not me.
I do. I will.
What about Mr. Anderson?
Since I had a 10 on my power roll, I'll go in there.
Oh, you're all probably busting ahead of me to do go in.
Yeah, like nothing to fear. Kind of like I'm gonna
stay just outside the door and look.
You guard our back. Keep the door open. Make sure no one shuts.
I didn't shut the door.
Mr. Anderson, do you go inside?
Yeah, I guess I'll follow behind the other two down.
All right. So you enter into the room, and beautiful ballroom. And you get to, you get about 10 feet from the door when the door slams shut on Hawk's face. And when you turn around, what you see beside the door is a huge black mirror. And you can hear, and now all three of you can hear this whispering in the back of your head. Do you look in the mirror?
With my history.
Look in the mirror.
I think I might need to take another power roll in order to look into the mirror.
Well, if you want to just look, you can look.
I would look because Anderson doesn't know any of the facts.
You don't know anything, yeah.
All right, Tommy, do you look inside?
Yeah, I think I have to.
Yeah, why not?
All right. All right. So we'll start with Henry. Henry, when you look into the mirror, you see the Crimson Beast standing right behind you with its crooked joint neck literally right beside your head, and it turns to you and its mouth splits open, revealing in the lining of its mouth these eyes and these suction cups, and it's coming towards your face and you can feel it dripping onto your shoulder.
Nope, I'm out of here. Bob, get me out of here. Get me out of here. I start banging out.
Can I say too that I was expecting that door to slam shut, and as soon as it did, I immediately started bashing it to try to get it open again.
All right. So
you can hear me over here bashing at the door.
So Henry's freaking out. Trent, you looked in the mirror?
Yep.
Yeah.
Trent, when you look in the mirror, you don't see yourself.
Nice.
You see your father. And he's standing in the reflection, and he looks back at you, and he says, "Trent, you're a failure. You never should have been fucking born." And he takes a gun from his pocket and bam, blows his brains out in front of you, and you feel the blood and gore splatter on the side of your face.
Oh, I'm gonna jump away and freak out a little bit about that.
All right.
Like in the face, looking at my hands, do I see anything?
You're looking at yourself and you see nothing, but when you look back in the mirror, you see everything all over you, and you can see your father on the ground, blood spewing from his head. Jeff, when you look in the mirror, you see Caleb. And his eyes are large, and he's got this huge gaping hole right in the center of his chest. And he says, and he leans in, and he cups his mouth, and he says, "They killed me. I'm not in hell. Hell doesn't exist. I'm somewhere worse. They killed me. Kill them. Kill them." I need you to roll a power roll.
Hard.
All right. So you have this urge to turn to the other two in the room and attack them, but you fight through it. I need you to all give me sanity rolls now.
Can I just say I failed?
I have failed.
Yeah, I did.
One and roll and I passed.
All right. To everyone that failed, I need you to give me a 1d6. To everyone who passed, I need you to take off 2 sanity points.
Nice.
Oh, only one.
Four for me.
All right. So Tommy literally shits his pants, and Hawk, you bang. Essentially, all you do is you bang on the door once, and the door comes flying open, and the three of them run out.
All right. Well, if that happens, then I'm now in the room because I bashed it with my shoulder, so I broke through, and they've run out, and now I'm in there.
So, yeah, I lagged out a little bit. So you guys are going to need to tell me what you guys just did, because you guys came flying out of the room. You bash into Hawk.
Oh, did you lag a little there, you said?
I did. I lagged a little bit.
Okay. I bashed with my shoulder, and I broke through the door. And as I did, I entered the room as they all went out the room.
All right.
So I'm in the room.
Which means that you get to see, this is a good place to end on. You look up to see them running down the hallway, and you turn your head slightly to the right, and you see the black mirror. And what do you see in the black mirror? You see an open vista of snow and tall mountains in the distance. There's a pulsing blue light every 3 seconds, and you can feel it like a heartbeat, thumping, thumping. And you can see black tendrils lifting up into the sky. And you can feel the wind and the cold. And you get up, and you fucking run.
Yeah. Out I go. Yep, that's a good spot to end. Out you go. All right, let's go ahead and end it there then. Our players included Corey Heisted, Sean Little, Mick Swan, Jeff Wilkins, Wayne Worthy, and myself, with Thompson McKeon as the Keeper of the Secrets. Please consider visiting our Patreon account. Just a few dollars a month will help us greatly. We're currently producing 4 shows a week with music and sound effects added in post-production in order to create a richer listener experience. Our musical intro is entitled Insidious and is provided royalty-free from Purple Planet Music. We're also providing audio-only versions of our shows free for you to download from Podbean or iTunes. Feel free to send us comments on the show. We'd love to hear from you. If you enjoyed our broadcast, please give us a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel for updates on our latest shows. You'll find links to everything I mentioned in the description below. This is Tom Rayleigh inviting you to journey with us once again into the darkness for another adventure into the universe of H.P. Lovecraft and the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. Until next time, good luck and good gaming. Patreon account. Just a few dollars a month will help us greatly. We're currently producing 4 shows a week with music and sound effects added in post-production in order to create a richer listener experience. Our musical intro is entitled Insidious and is provided royalty-free from Purple Planet Music. We're also providing audio-only versions of our shows free for you to download from Podbean or iTunes. Feel free to send us comments on the show. We'd love to hear from you. If you enjoyed our broadcast, please give us a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel for updates on our latest shows. You'll find links to everything I mentioned in the description below. This is Tom Raley inviting you to journey with us once again into the darkness for another adventure into the universe of H.P. Lovecraft and the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. Until next time, good luck and good gaming.